This video is going to be about the harmonics of standing waves, which are patterns that form at certain frequencies and wavelengths in a material that has a standing wave in it. We're going to start with the harmonics of a material that is fixed at both ends, that can't oscillate on either end. One important note before we start is that the velocity of any wave in a medium is the same as all other waves in the same medium. This is always a little bit surprising to students when they first find it out, but it is true. As an example, all sound waves in 20 degrees Celsius air move at 343 meters per second. All waves in a pond with the same temperature throughout move at the same velocity. So if you have the same medium, the same type of wave will move through it at the same velocity as all other waves in that medium. This is going to be really important for the harmonics of standing waves. This means that for any material, an increase in frequency will cause a decrease in wavelength. A decrease in frequency will cause an increase in wavelength, but neither will change the velocity of the wave. If the wave is in the same material, it will always have the same velocity. So that means that if you change either the frequency or the wavelength, that's going to cause a change in the other rather than a change in the velocity. Let's say that we have a material fixed at both ends so that it can't move. We'll begin to send waves through it to create a standing wave. Because the ends are fixed, they can't move. The only time standing waves will occur is when there are nodes at both ends of the material, because nodes are places on the standing wave that do not move. So if the endpoints can't move, they have to be nodes for the standing wave to work. So let's observe which standing waves we could make with nodes at both ends of this rope. This is the first example. We can imagine this rope oscillating up and down in this way. So you can see here this pattern has two nodes and one antinode in the middle. We could also make this pattern. We're allowed to make any pattern that has a node at either end. So this pattern would also work. So this pattern is another possible standing wave in this material. You can see this time there are three nodes and two antinodes. This is another pattern that would work because, again, we just need to have nodes at either end of the material. And this is another pattern that would work. Each possible standing wave in a material is called a harmonic of that material. For now, I'm going to say that we number the harmonics by their antinodes. It's actually a little bit more complicated than that. I'll explain that later in the video. For example, a harmonic with three antinodes is called the third harmonic. We can identify physical patterns in the shapes of the harmonics. So I'm going to take you through each harmonic and observe certain patterns that emerge. We also refer to the first harmonic of a material as the fundamental harmonic or fundamental mode of the material. Just to visualize what's happening at those fixed endpoints in terms of the reflection of waves, as one of the waves moves into that fixed point, we know that it's reflected and inverted by the rule for reflecting waves. And you can see that when that one traveling wave crest moves into the fixed point, it's reflected back, and those total amplitudes always add together to make zero because they're perfectly balancing each other out. I'm going to observe that one more time. Those two amplitudes always add to zero at the very end of the material because they're perfectly balancing each other out. So the traveling waves that make up that standing wave are constantly being reflected and inverted at the endpoints. And because they're being reflected and inverted, you can see that their amplitudes are perfectly canceling each other out. So if I were to look at the amplitude of the standing wave there, that's always going to be an amplitude of zero because the amplitude of the traveling waves are canceling each other out. So that's how our understanding of the reflection of waves helps us understand the behavior of standing waves in different types of material. So for material that's fixed at both ends, the reason why there's a node there is also because the waves are reflecting and inverting. And so at the very end, their amplitudes always add together to make zero. This is a visualization of that same process, just stretched out to a full standing wave. So you can imagine that the blue wave is actually just a reflection of the red wave moving in the material. So when the red wave moves to the left and hits that fixed point at the end of the material, it's reflected and inverted and becomes the blue wave. The blue wave moves back through, is eventually reflected and inverted at the other fixed point, and becomes the red wave again. So this is another reason why fixed endpoints are always nodes on a standing wave in a material. I'm now going to find some patterns in the harmonics of this material. To start with the notation, we can call the wavelength of each harmonic lambda with some number next to it, where n is the number of the harmonic. There's a mathematical relationship between the length of the material, the number of the harmonic, and the wavelength of the standing wave. So let's observe what that is. I'm going to imagine that I have a material of length L. I'm imagining that this is a rope. And I'm going to create that first harmonic shape in it and observe some patterns about the wavelength and frequency of the standing wave in its first harmonic in a material of length L. I can see, first of all, that if I draw out the full wavelength of that wave being created, that full wavelength is actually equal to 2L, two times the length of the material that the wave is being created in. So here, in a material that's fixed at both ends, we would say that the wavelength of the first harmonic is equal to two times the length of the material. This will always be true. In the second harmonic here, I can see that the wavelength is exactly equal to the length of the material. In the third harmonic, I can see that the wavelength is equal to 2/3 of the full material. And in the fourth harmonic, I can see that the wavelength is equal to 1/2 of the length of the material. I can see there's a pattern emerging where the wavelength of a certain harmonic is equal to 2 over the number of the harmonic times the length of the material. This pattern will always hold for material fixed at both ends. We can use the equation for the wavelength of a harmonic and the fact that the velocity remains the same in the same material to find the frequency of each harmonic. I'm going to use this notation for the frequency of different harmonics. It's just f with a subscript number that's going to be the harmonic number. So for example, the frequency of the third harmonic will be called f3. f1 is the frequency of the first harmonic, and it's also often called the fundamental frequency of the material. So the fundamental frequency of the material can be thought of as the exact frequency that you need to oscillate the material to create a single large first harmonic standing wave in that material. For these problems, I'm assuming that the velocity is remaining constant at v. So we know that for any harmonic number, the velocity is going to remain constant because it's the same velocity in the same material. So for any harmonic, the velocity is going to be equal to that harmonic's wavelength times that harmonic's frequency. If I rearrange this, I get the frequency at any harmonic is equal to v over that wavelength. And because I know the wavelength is equal to 2 over the number of the harmonic times L, I can rearrange the equation in this way. So the frequency at any harmonic is the number of the harmonic times the velocity over 2 times the length of the material. And you'll notice that this is equal to the number of the harmonic times the fundamental frequency, because the fundamental frequency of the first harmonic is where n equals 1, so that's just going to be v over 2L. So the frequency of any harmonic is just going to be equal to that harmonic number times the frequency of the first harmonic. So that means that if the frequency of this first standing wave on top is f1, the second harmonic is going to have twice the frequency of the first. And this is true. You can see that in the animation, the second harmonic is oscillating up and down at twice the frequency of the first. It completes twice as many oscillations in the same time as the first one does. So the third harmonic will have 3 times the frequency of the first, and the fourth harmonic will have 4 times the frequency of the first. Another way that I think about these frequencies, this is just the amount that you have to oscillate the wave to create exactly that pattern in the material. If you and a friend were holding something like a jump rope and sending waves through it, it would be pretty easy to oscillate it up and down slowly to create that first pattern on top, but you would each have to move your hands faster to make the second pattern, and even faster to make the third pattern, and even faster than that to make the fourth pattern. So these frequencies tell you exactly how frequently you should oscillate your hands while you're holding the jump rope to make each pattern emerge. This is an example problem that we can solve using our new understanding of wavelength and frequency in different harmonics. This standing wave in a rope with two fixed ends oscillates with a period of 0.167 seconds. What would the period be if the wavelength of the wave were 3 meters? So just picking apart the information, I can see that this is the third harmonic. So the period of the third harmonic is 0.167 seconds. So the frequency is 1 over that, which is equal to 6 hertz. And I know that because this is the third harmonic, that's equal to 3 times the fundamental frequency. So the fundamental frequency of this material must be 2 hertz. That's the frequency required to create the first harmonic in the material. We need to know which harmonic the wave will be in when the wavelength is 3 meters. That's what the question is asking about. So the wavelength of this harmonic is equal to 3 meters. And that's also going to be equal to 2 over the number of the harmonic times the length of the material, which here is 9. So multiplying that out, I find that this wave will have to be in the 6th harmonic for the wavelength to equal 3 meters. So just to clarify that, that means that it's going to look like this, with 6 antinodes. And you can see that each full wavelength there, going all the way up and then all the way down and then back to the node, is going to be 3 meters long. I know that the frequency of the 6th harmonic will be 6 times the frequency of the first, which is equal to 12 hertz. So to find the period of this wave, I just take 1 over that frequency and I get 0.083 seconds, and that is the answer that I was looking for. So that will be the period of oscillation if the wavelength were 3 meters instead of what it is right now, which is 6 meters. These next two sections will be much shorter. I just need to introduce some slightly different rules when one or both ends of the material is free to oscillate. We'll start with just one end that's free to oscillate. So if one end of a material is not fixed and is free to oscillate, the wave will be reflected back without being inverted. You'll remember that also from the wave reflection lecture. If one end of the material is open to oscillate, reflection still happens, but the wave will not be inverted when it moves backwards. So because the wave is not being inverted, the amplitude of the original wave and the amplitude of the reflected wave are actually going to add together to produce a single larger amplitude. So if you watch this red wave be reflected into the blue wave and observe the amplitudes of both, you'll notice that the two amplitudes are adding together. So again, as it's reflected, the amplitude of the red and the amplitude of the blue are pointing in the same direction, so that means that they are going to add together to be a single maximum point, the antinode. And notice that they're not constantly at that highest height, they do eventually both drop down to zero, but the antinodes of a standing wave also drop back down to zero, they just go up again to the top after, so they oscillate like that. So these two amplitudes are adding together. So what I'm trying to get across here is that if you have a material with one open end, that open end will always act as an antinode, and the fixed end will always be a node. You can see here, we can imagine that the red wave and blue waves are reflections of each other. When the red wave hits the left side of the material, it's reflected back as the blue wave, and here the blue wave's amplitude is in the same direction when it's reflected back to the right. And so those two amplitudes add together to produce an antinode. When reflection happens on the fixed point on the right, the blue wave is inverted into the red wave, and so the two cancel out at that one point and form a node. So again, for material fixed at just one end, the open end will always be an antinode, and the fixed end will always be a node. Now that we know that the fixed end must be a node and the oscillating end must be an antinode, let's see if we can find a mathematical relationship between wavelength, frequency, the harmonic number, and the length of the material when we have one oscillating end. Here the harmonic number will go up by 2 as we go to each wave. This is confusing notation, I'll explain why we use it in a moment. So you can see instead of going from the first to the second to the third harmonic, we're just skipping straight from the first to the third, then the fifth, then the seventh, and so on. And we're going to see if we can find a total pattern out of that. Again, I'll explain why in just a minute. So to make a standing wave, I just need to place a node at the fixed point and an antinode at the not fixed point. So the simplest standing wave I could make would look like this. This is the first harmonic of that oscillating string. I cannot make a simpler standing wave that has a node on the left and an antinode on the right. So I can see that the wavelength of this wave is actually 4 times the is actually four times the original material. What I'm looking at there is only one quarter of a full wave pattern. So the first harmonic here is going to have a wavelength of 4L, rather than what we were looking at when we were dealing with two fixed points. There, the first harmonic only had a wavelength of 2L. So these properties change depending on which ends are fixed. If you have trouble memorizing them, just drawing these pictures that show where the nodes and antinodes have to be can help. The frequency is equal to the velocity of the wave over the wavelength, so that's going to be V over 4L. So the very next harmonic here is called the third harmonic. There's no possible harmonic here between the first and the third. So again, it seems like this should be called the second harmonic, especially because it very clearly only has two antinodes. I'll explain why we call it the third harmonic in just a moment. I can see here that the wavelength is going to be 4/3 times the length of the material. Because if you chop that material into thirds and just added one more third, that would be exactly enough for the wave to complete one full wavelength. That means that the frequency is going to be V over 4/3 L, which is equal to 3V over 4L. And you'll notice that that's equal to 3 times the original fundamental frequency. The very next possible harmonic we call the fifth harmonic. It's going to look like this. These are the patterns that emerge. And finally, this is the seventh harmonic. And these are the patterns that emerge here. So you'll notice that no matter what, all of these are following this pattern here. The wavelength is equal to 4 over the harmonic number times L, and the frequency is equal to N times that first harmonic. So before I had said that the number of the harmonic is the number of antinodes, but that's not actually correct. The more precise definition of the number of the harmonic is the number we need to multiply the fundamental frequency by to get the harmonic pattern. And here, in order to form each new harmonic, we actually have to multiply by the next odd integer, not just the next integer. So we call the harmonics the first and third and fifth harmonic, because those are the numbers that we need to multiply the frequency by to get to them. So there's no second or fourth harmonic, because no standing wave forms in this material with one open end when you oscillate the material at a frequency of 2 times the fundamental frequency. These standing waves only occur at every odd integer. The last type of harmonic to talk about is when both ends are free to oscillate. Here, again, we can just observe this standing wave where both ends are free to oscillate. You'll notice that the red and blue waves can each be thought of as reflections of each other. And the reflections where, because the ends are free to oscillate, they go backwards but with the same direction of amplitude. Every time they hit the end of the material, they're reflected back with the same direction of amplitude and in the opposite direction of motion, because both ends are free to oscillate. So you can see that this means that both ends of the material are going to be antinodes. We can now begin to draw the harmonics, given the fact that the ends of the rope must be antinodes. This is the first possible harmonic, with an antinode at each end. We can't just draw the waves as straight lines going from left to right. It has to follow the general pattern of the wave. So to have two antinodes there, we need one node in the middle. So that's going to be the first harmonic. You'll notice here that the wavelength is 2 times the length of the material, and the frequency is the velocity over 2 times that length. The second harmonic can be drawn like this. These are the properties that emerge. This will be the next possible harmonic, the third harmonic. This is the wavelength and frequency. And this is the fourth harmonic here. And so a standing wave with material not fixed at either end actually forms the same pattern for the wavelength and frequency as the standing wave when the material is fixed at both ends. The wavelength of the nth harmonic will be 2 over n all times L, and the frequency of the nth harmonic will be n times that first frequency. Those are the patterns that emerge in the harmonics of standing waves.